So hi guys, welcome to Ustream. We have Miss Khaleesi. Miss Khaleesi. And me. If you want to speak to me on Ustream, then you need to call me through Skype. So my Skype is LisaCairns12, and just call me or send me a message, and when I've got time I will answer or I'll speak with you. So you, when you call me, you also put Ustream on quiet. And then you speak to me through Skype. You can also send me written questions. I was going to do this whole thing about not recording Sundays and only recording Wednesdays. But then Wednesdays didn't record, so I'm just going to record them and see what happens. And maybe if you really don't want to be recorded, you can say something and I'll see how I feel. If you want to come to one of my events, I've just done an event this weekend in London, which was really beautiful. We just finished. So now this will be something like my, oh no, only 4th hour today that I've been talking about non-duality. Not that much, eh, Khaleesi? Just can go on and on and on. So I've just done the war weekend talks near London, and then the next one's in Berlin, Germany. That's the 15th to the 17th. Hey, Jeffrey. Hi, Maria. Hey, Robin. So next weekend is, next one is Berlin, 15th to the 17th, eh? And then a retreat in Romania. The 30th to the 6th of August. And then there's a talk in Bucharest, Romania, the 6th of August. And then retreat in southern Spain, which is really great for intensive. It's 2 weeks, the 18th to the 1st of November. The 18th of October to the 1st of November. You can also do the first week of that, but you can't do the second week. You can just do the first week. And then you can also do 2 weeks. Hey, Easy. The drives are wild if I blow her. Give her a little blow. Thank you. She's so sweet. So, welcome to Ustream. Hey, Cassie. Hey, Cassie. This is Cassidy. Come on, Cass. This is the one that breaks your ears. Come on, Cass Cass. Cass Cass. Cass Cass. Cassie. 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 So, non-duality. It, baby. Stating the obvious, eh? Hey, Colin. Hi, Lewis. Hey, Robin. Hi, Mitch to lead. Mitch to lead. Hey, Milfred. Heard some of these names. There always needs to be relationship. In order to be separate, you in relationship with someone or something. There's a belief that there is an end to you and a beginning of something else. There is something else that begins out there that's separate from me. In practical terms, this is what can be described. There is Lisa and Khaleesi and Cassidy in this house, but in the experience, there is never an inside or outside, and this is the most important part. But we, as humans, tend to believe what we think more than what's actually happening. So what we think reality is more than what reality actually is. So in the experience, there is no outside of you and there is no inside of you. In thoughts, in words, in time, then that's what it seems that there is Lisa, there is Cassidy, there is Khaleesi, there is my drink, there is my iPhone, there is Siri, there is cushion, there is chair. In time, that seems to be the case. But in actuality, in the actual experience, which is the most important, there is no inside or outside, but the human is totally lost in the dream of itself, in the dream of words, in the dream of time. It believes that's the only reality, and that me and you are the way things are, that self and other, that division is the way things are. But what's actually happening right now? Is there an outside of presence? Is there an outside of knowing of this? But that's too far out there for even most people to see that who they believe they are is something which is appearing rather than an experience. That who they think they are, this person inside this body, this tightly contracted energy, is an experiencer rather than an experience. And if it's an experience appearing in this, then there isn't a divided reality because all things are appearances. They're not reality. So if you is an appearance, so is the other equally. They're both appearances appearing in the kaleidoscope of this dream. So in experience, you can see that there's something experiencing the person, and the person isn't the experiencer. But the experiencer is non-located. It's not found. It's not something that you can find. You can't look back there and find it. The experiencer is not located. It is everywhere and nowhere. It is the knowing of all things, which is all things, and it's not one thing. So now you appear, and you might appear with this thought that's like, what's she talking about? I do not understand. But my, she has a very beautiful fringe. Look how she's cut her fringe. Yes, I wonder if I could have a fringe like that. And that feels like you. But notice that person is being experienced. That one that's having the conversation is known. It's being watched. It's not the actual knower of things. It's being watched. It is known. That's massive. That's really profound. So if you see that who you think you are is an experience appearing in it and not the actual experiencer, then there is a huge shift in the way life is. Because suddenly, if you is an appearance as well, this isn't a divided universe. It means there is no inside and outside of experiencing. Therefore, who you truly are is not divided. The other is contained in you. As that divine as that hugeness. Yakata! Isn't that wonderful? I mean, this is just profound. Shocking. So even that one that thinks it understands what I say is also known. It is also an experience. That's being seen, that's appearing. So something sees that. But that one looks back and it's like, oh, brain freeze, like after eating an ice cream. Oh, it looks back on itself, trying to see itself. But it can't, it is being seen. So it tries to look back and understand what I say, but it's being seen. Yak-a-dak-a-dak-a-dak. So I'm playing with Khaleesi, I'm not just a total weirdo. Although I am a weirdo. I'm quite happy to take that title. So Lisa is being experienced. So the appearance of Lisa, so Lisa isn't really appearing as much now. So vague, Lisa, but there's an appearance of Lisa and there's an appearance of Khaleesi. But who I am, who's speaking, is that boundless knowing. Is the experiencer, which is non-located, but yet all things. It isn't found anywhere. Yet it knows it all. And the knowing isn't removed from what's appearing. And this profoundly changes the character. So Lisa is profoundly changed and lots of it's disappeared. But Lisa still has her flavour. She still has a neurosis. She still has her beauty. She still has her quirks and personality. She still looks like that bundle of energy of Lisa. But Lisa is no longer the experiencer. The experiencer is non-located, is not a location, and it's all things. Everywhere and nowhere. It knows itself, but not from a location. It looks through this body, but the perceiver cannot be found. It perceives as if it's looking from this angle, but it cannot be found in this world. Everything in this world is a perception, is perceived. Or you could even say everything in this world is perceiving. It's amazing. So you think, oh, what's she talking about? Oh, should I go and play soccer tonight or not? Don't play soccer, you're terrible at soccer. Everyone will laugh at you for playing soccer. Oh, why do you always get down on yourself? Da, 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 da. And notice that one that's so involved in itself, that tight bound energy that believes it's choosing, is being experienced. Who experiences that? Who knows that? Me, 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 me. Who? The reason why the energy stays in being bound, in being someone, is because as soon as it separates, it then believes its mission is to find wholeness again. But it believes wholeness is in time. So it begins this mechanism, like spinning a wheel, you know, like it gets faster and faster and faster. It believes that it will find it in the next thing. And then it keeps adding to itself. It keeps moving faster and faster and faster, trying to find it. And it keeps growing in the next thing. It becomes a seeker, always looking for wholeness. As soon as it separates, it longs for itself again. It feels like there's something missing, and it's always trying to find that thing that's missing. And more it plays that game, the stronger and stronger the game gets, because it can never find it. It can never be found in the flow of things. And then after 30 or 40 years of the game, a lot of people begin to feel uncomfortable, but begin to feel dead or begin to feel hopeless. And then if you're more sensitive, there tends to be an exploration of this subject. Why am I alive? Okay, let's take some questions. So I think there's been people calling already. So if you've called already, I might have missed you. So please just send me another message saying that you want to call. Hi, Lisa. This is. Sorry, guys. I'm what society calls really badly dyslexic, although I don't see it as a negative. I see it as a really beautiful thing. It should be something like I'm an artist. It's really beautiful. But it means that putting sounds and letters together is not my forte. I find it quite difficult. So I can't read your name. This is K and J together. I can't make out what sound that would be. I can't remember. Kajatan, maybe? I'm watching your Ustream and I have a question about relationships. I don't know quite how to make the question conscious to make the question concise and to the point, but I'm looking for clarification on how to shift my mind from horizontal relating to being with what is true to me. Well, really, you can't shift your mind to anything because who is that you that wants to shift it? And what would you shift it to? We get into so many bizarre ideas about what we think we want. So you want to shift your mind to the horizontal. Kartan. Ah, Kartan, that's how you say it. Thank you for that. Yeah, if you spell things phonetically, guys, that's so much better for me. Kartan. Yeah, thank you for that. It just looks so bizarre, a K and a J for me. I couldn't even work out a sound. Chartan, sorry, it would be Chartan. Okay, I'm Chartan. So. Basically, you're still in the idea that you want to be something better than what you are, even though you feel the new idea is that you want to go from the horizontal to the vertical way of relating to someone. You still have this idea of yourself that wants to get to a better position in the future, and this is destined to fail. This is the illusion of self. It believes it's something and then it wants to be something else. And this isn't the way to go about it. Though this is a message of love, of totally and utterly falling in love with yourself in every way, and the acceptance of what's appearing. But that's not your action to accept it. That's something that will begin to happen. It's such a beautiful thing. It really is the end of rejecting anything you are. So if you feel uncomfortable because you're relating to someone in an erotic way, it's the absolute exposing and accepting of that. That's what's appearing. So, what I recommend when you feel separate, there isn't really someone there that has choice and free will, but when you feel separate, you feel like you have choice and free will. But it's an absolute illusion. The one that feels like it's choosing, and even if I give you a recommendation and a suggestion, that one that feels like it's choosing isn't the chooser, but it is an interactive program, an interactive robot, so by me saying this, it more than likely will do it. But what I would recommend is to explore what's underneath that feeling of wanting to relate in a vertical way. So if you explore that feeling, you'll see that even the wish to want to be enlightened or want to relate in that way comes from a sense of lack. And I would just rest your attention on that lack. It's no big deal. It doesn't need to be fulfilled. It's known, and the knowing is the freedom, and just letting it be there. So you feel not enough. You don't need to fulfill that with anything. Everything you think about that you need to put in there isn't true. So you think that you need to be something in the future or relate better in the future because you feel not enough now. You feel like you've related badly or you feel like you've not been successful in relationships and then you feel like you would like this other thing. But actually, just if you're honest with yourself, I just feel like I'm not enough and I want to be loved. I would like to be loved. And just acknowledge that rather than playing on the surface level. Or the more surface level, although it's not surface level for most people, that's pretty deep that you would like to relate in a different way. But rather than seeing it as something to get, just accept what's actually happening. And actually, when you speak it and say it, rather than try to seek for something else, it actually feels very relaxing. I don't feel loved. I don't feel enough. And that's why I'm imagining relating better. Just rest the attention on the body. So, if there's a discomfort in the torso or in the heart area around this subject, just rest the attention there. And it will shift and change when it shifts and changes. It might have some stuff to say, it might want to cry. There is Netflix confession coming over your Ustream. Ah! Oh, sorry, you missed the answer to your question. I don't think I could repeat it. So you can just listen to it back on Ustream. That will be at about 25 minutes. You can listen back. Sorry,
Hour
sweetie,
because
it seems to keep deleting stuff. Okay, so who should we move on to next? So can I just also say before. Oh, you got the majority of my answer. Oh, good. You can watch it back from about 25 minutes, I think it'll be. Say hi, Marianne Goodwell. I will talk to you in just a moment. I just want to speak about talking with me. Now, this is very important because there is a particular way that you speak with masters like myself. You have to bow very seriously and genuinely and use the word namaste a lot. Namaste, namaste, namaste. And I always like your head slightly lower than my head. So if you see that I'm at this level on Ustream, when you greet me on Skype, just make sure that you're further down the screen. So maybe you're like this level on the screen. So if my head is up here, you make sure your head's down there. So, just so you know how to speak to great masters like myself. No. It's funny when you tell a joke and there's nobody else in the room to laugh, so you're like, ha! Ba-boom! And nobody else laughs because there's no one here except the dogs. And they don't find me funny. Anyway, what I was going to say, when you speak with me, guys, so it of course most people are going to be nervous. So you're going to feel nervous energy come up because you're not used to being on it and you're sitting there in your home all alone and then suddenly here I am and you get the nervous energy and there's people listening to you and it's recorded. So you really can take your time. I really don't care if you go into silence or you say, I don't know what to say, or you say you feel shy, but you don't need to speak at a million miles an hour and try to get every last detail in. I'm not criticizing anyone or saying anyone's wrong. If that's what happens, that's what happens. But I notice that that often happens because people are feeling a lot of energy rush through them because they're having adrenaline because they feel nervous. And it's not like your choice to stop doing that, but like any computer program, if I tell them to do something, they can do something. I will give you an example. Hi Siri, could you bring me up some websites on sex clubs near to here?
I didn't find anything on the web for on sex clubs near to here.
Oh. Okay, sorry. That was the wrong question to ask. Hi Siri, could you pull up some websites on Thai takeaways, please.
Here's what I found on the web for websites on Thai takeaways, please.
Ta-da! So look. Oh, Siri can follow instructions, just like your body can, but it's not you doing it. It's a program, an interactive program that's written that's incredibly smart and intelligent. So basically, what I'm informing you, the information that I'm informing, is you don't need to be anything. So if you feel nervous, it's okay to just sit there quietly and be, I feel nervous. It's okay. What we love about people is their honesty, believe it or not. Even if you think saying you feel nervous makes you weak because you want to seem enlightened, actually, it makes you so incredibly strong saying it. Pretending to be enlightened makes you weak. Everyone can feel it. So if you're pretending to be enlightened, it can be felt. Okay, so. Very funny about the master, and we should bow our head below certain screen level. Good one. It's so funny though, Isabel. You tell the joke and then nobody laughs when you're on your stream. Except yourself. Hey, David, you'd like to talk as well. Okay, I'm just going to take it from Marianne Goodell.
Let me turn off the volume. Hold on one
Okay,
sec.
okay. Hey.
Hey, am I low enough?
Just, you actually are very low, but I'm hoping that's not because you took my advice. You're like right at the bottom of the screen.
Last time I think when we spoke, we talked about
I
how I
can't
was
see your face, you know, because the light. So I can't actually recognize you from before.
I don't. You've never seen me.
Oh, I've never seen you. That's
No.
why then. You said we
Is
spoke
that better?
before. Yeah, that's
We've
better. Yeah.
talked about that, but I've always hidden.
Oh, I've not seen your face before. Oh, nice. Do
Hi.
you know, and I don't recognize you at all because the way I recognize people is by it's like seeing their energy and seeing their movement. So, because even though we've spoken, I cannot remember you. But normally, I always recognize people's faces and when I see them.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. Before I didn't want to show my face. So there you
Yeah.
go.
I don't remember what we talked about at all. It's totally gone.
We've spoken a couple of times. The one time it's all pretty much kind of a sequential thing. The first time was a lot about choice, and we
Yeah.
talked about, and we talked at that point. The thing that was helpful that you said was you talked about how in a tribe of monkeys or apes that how each of them have their roles and
Yes.
whatnot. And then the last time that we spoke, it was another one where I would tend to hide behind non-duality when I was doing behaviors that weren't necessarily beneficial.
Yeah.
And so I've taken that advice, and now what I'm noticing is as I operate, I'm seeing more and more of, I don't even know that I would say I'm seeing it, but I'm kind of, there's this element that it's not a Marianne talking to a Lisa.
Yeah.
It's a, I don't even know what to say, but so I'm experiencing that, and it's becoming more evident or more out there until I encounter family members.
Ah.
And then I literally notice a constriction within myself.
Yeah.
And it's like the rest of the world, there's this great, I mean, an empathy, a forgiveness, not even a forgiveness, but an acceptance,
Yeah.
seeing a beauty. The other day I saw a little gal who was mentally handicapped, and before it would have been, oh, how horrible for her family or how
Yeah.
horrible for her. And all of a sudden I was like, well, but of course.
Yeah.
For her, but then a family member might walk in, and I'm all constricted and like, why do they act like that? Why do
Yeah.
they act that way? Why don't they? How?
Yeah.
What the heck?
Yeah. Yeah, this is quite a complicated part, but it's really obvious when you really understand the functioning of yourself, how that's happened. It's basically because you've sold yourself to them in the sense, and they've sold themselves to you. You've behaved how they've wanted in order. Sorry, Alanga keeps calling. It's so funny when he does that, it goes right over your face. He was doing that the other day, but I've moved you to a place that I don't think he'll appear now. So basically, you've repetitively over years sold yourself to them, and they've sold themselves to you. Now, what I mean is, you've collectively agreed to behave a certain way in order for there to be the most peaceful situation. Now, I'm not saying it is peaceful, I'm saying the most because it could be worse. But you've all agreed to take on certain roles and behaviour and to stick to it. Now, you've not consciously agreed, you've unconsciously agreed. So you've all agreed, even if you don't like your role in the family, even if you're the bad one or the screw up or the whatever it is, or the helper, whichever role it is, you've agreed to be that role. And everyone has their fixed role. And you and the others all have to commit to their roles in order for the family to work. And sometimes you're allowed to change roles and be slightly different, but most of the time you have to be the person that they've known over the years. And you have to stay to that, and you're not allowed to change.
And when
And
you change,
huh?
and then when you change,
They can't handle it. They can't.
you in their presence, right? Because
Sorry?
then, nor can you in your in their presence, because then it's like you have to get back into
To the
that.
old role. So this is why it brings up suffering for you again and again, because you've all collectively agreed to be people together in order for peace, actually. That's why, because if you all take on these roles, then you all know how to behave together and you all know what the rules are. But what it actually does is it constricts you and it makes you passively aggressive to each other.
Yes,
So
and
you're,
really not enjoy each other.
yeah, so you don't want to, you want to ref pull away from each other. Sometimes you'll enjoy it. Oh, sometimes. So lovely eyes, or he. He's a nice guy.
She,
She.
it's no,
Part of the reason I was late today, actually, was this beautiful husky decided to tag on, and we had to take it home again. And it had the most, you know, those huskies with like bright blue eyes. You're like, oh, looks at you, and it's like, as you should. It was very sweet. But so you've all collectively agreed, and it makes you all safe because you know who the mother is. And I mean, imagine if your mother suddenly started behaving radically different. It would be shocking. It makes you all feel safe in a way because you know what how to relate to each other. But it makes you passive aggressive. It makes you all a bit frustrated, and it makes you like one thing that I can't stand in families. And I'm so lucky. My family are really. I mean, there's issues, but one thing I like about my families is they're very on the surface. So even though actually they most probably argue more, I hope my mum's not going to be watching this one. She most probably will now. She'll be in Canada, like. So we most probably argue for what some people would be, but we don't argue as in we. I feel what I like about my family. We have other negatives. If we're very expressive, so if we feel annoyed, we show our annoyance. And I find it difficult when I meet families, when I've had boyfriends or friends, families that are those nice families that are always like, oh no, let me help you. And they're like really sickly sweet. No, I'll put, let me put it over here for, no, let me take your bag. Like my family isn't, my mum's, I come into the house, you know, and I haven't seen her. She's like, have you got your shoes on? And like, I like that energy. Like my mum is so out there, like so open to being and saying, she doesn't think, oh, I shouldn't say that. She just says it. But there's an honesty there. I'm not saying that our fam my family is enlightened, but I like that honesty. A lot of the time in families, you're all playing a game to get on, but it makes you all unhappy and constricted and tense. So there's an underlying tension. And if any of you try to change, the others will all gang up on you because everyone's pissed off. They've had to play this game. This is not conscious at all. This is all unconscious. But they get annoyed because they've had to fake it. They've had to be this role. Then how dare you change? And so there's an annoyance there when anyone does begin to question what they think or feel. And so it's a really interesting, funky dance. And I think it's great for family to challenge what's still left there. like what issues still get stuck, because you're going, it's like a way of a warrior, because you're going to upset people and people aren't going to like you changing. You don't have to wear non-duality on your t-shirt and speak about it with them, but just in your whole being, when you begin to deconstruct yourself, your personality is going to change radically.
And so, because I think that's happened, yeah, I don't wear it on my sleeve. I don't think, I mean, I think there was a period of time I was wearing pretend enlightenment, and then I was, but now I know it's not there. So it's like, whatever. But there is, I mean, yes, I don't play by the rules anymore necessarily, because I don't want to follow those. So yes, all that tension you describe is absolutely true. All the, so it is, it's a matter of whenever the get-togethers happen, it's a matter of enduring.
Yeah.
Even though on the surface, it looks pleasant.
Yeah.
But yeah. It's not, and so, and I think I leave there really, I even upset with myself for why can't I get along? Why don't I?
Yeah.
Why don't I, so then I think I leave there feeling like a jerk.
Yeah. Well, I would, but that's one thing if you feel like a jerk, but the whole, I see everything as like an experiment. So what in your situation, what I would do is I would go into these family parties as an experiment. And I would look at it like an experiment to see what's happening in that, in your body.
Okay.
So to see the reactions that's coming up in your body. So to be with people, to feel that urge to want to say something when you actually have nothing to say, but to feel that urge to say something, or to feel that urge of annoyance. So I would use it as an experiment to feel what's going on underneath your immediate reaction. So your reaction is to speak when actually you don't feel like speaking, or your reaction is annoyance at some comments, so you're going to be lost in the action, but every so often to just go back to the feeling and the sensation underneath and see what you're actually feeling. And more than likely, a lot of the time when you're in the family situation, what you're feeling is a lack or fear.
Totally.
Which then produces either over-talking or not talking or withdrawing or being grumpy or snapping or losing your temper.
Pretty much all, or I feel this like barrier come
yeah.
around. Just this, it's like I put on all this armor.
Yeah, yeah.
That, to go, like I'm going into battle.
Yeah.
Even though on the surface it does not appear as that at all. And if anybody looked, it would be, it's a pleasant conversation, it's a pleasant, but I think it is, it's the shedding of the roles maybe.
Pleasant conversation doesn't mean pleasantness. Pleasant conversations can often be very passive aggressive. Like, it's all about energy. Like, with my mum's feisty, she I don't know why I'm going for my mum tonight, but she's feisty and I love her spirit. She you know, when she was 30 in the 60s, she bought her own place by herself, which was totally outrageous, and she was a computer programmer. She's a feisty woman. And I never feel from my mum, even though she's got her issues and she can be fiery and she always says what she thinks, I never feel that passive aggression from her, that aggression that I feel... like, you're nice, but it's not nice. Even though my mum might not be described as a nice, nice person, I never feel that underlying thing that you have. So when someone's smiling and nice, energetically, we can sense it. It doesn't mean they're being nice, and it doesn't mean they have nice energy. What we actually like and we respond to is honesty. That's what makes us open, is actually someone being honest, even if they're being grumpy. You'll find if someone's grumpy and they're being honest, there's a genuineness there, then you'll have an open heart to them. It's when then they're all lying and they're all in a pickle trying to make you believe they're someone. Like trying to make you think that they're something other than they're not. This is when it gets all funny, the energies. When they're honest with you, even if it's anger, your energy naturally sinks and flows with them like a river. You flow together like a dance happens. If they're not doing that, what they're doing is they're blocking you and pushing you away.
Right.
And it is invasive. It's more invasive, someone energetically blocking you, than words. And you must notice that sometimes. Like, some people can say things and it's really offensive. Some people could say the exact same thing and it's totally not offensive. Which is also, it makes it so hard for laws of what's allowed and what's not allowed, because it depends on the energy it comes with. So even though it's nice on the surface, I'm just sure there's so many issues underneath of resentment and bitterness and...
Oh, there are. I mean, there's one, not to name family members, whatever, but I mean, I remember after going, this individual loves to hate me.
Yeah.
But the surface, it doesn't appear that way, but there's so much resentment that I feel.
Yeah.
And then, yes, of course, they're not good enough. I mean, it's totally, I've gone into, as I explore it afterwards, I can feel that. And I can feel one day I was going to go with one family member somewhere. And I was like, why don't I want to go? Why don't I want to go? And it was, I didn't want to be in that person's presence.
Yeah.
For that, because, yes, I think it does. We've got the pretty little package, but it's not really there. And then this feeling of, and I don't even know what this authentic me that I want to show is. I don't know that it's any different.
Authentic really is when you're acting from not a place. So now, when I feel we're talking, you're just speaking, and I'm just speaking. You're not giving it too much thought. The mouth just opens, and it's speaking. And it's not about giving it thought, but you're not trying to convince me you're someone.
Yes.
So then there's this, that is authentic. It's like, it's not about what we say. It's not being truthful. You know, I get all my stories confused and my memory's not great. It's this place of not trying to make the other believe you're something. It's an openness, an honesty. You're not, obviously the body's playing a game as in like it's all moving towards pleasure and avoiding pain, but in the moment it's just coming out rather than coming through this filter of trying to be something else. Like when the speakers, and when I say about coming from nothing, and this is going in and out all day. So in the day suddenly you get contracted and you feel offended and then you want to try to be something, or you go into a situation and suddenly the peacock feathers come out and you want to try to be something, and then that kind of switches off and you're making a cup of tea and then a genuineness comes out.
Right.
And so the authentic self doesn't look like anything. Depending on my energies, I can be so many different people. So I can be the sexual Lisa, I can be the loving Lisa, I can be the comic Lisa. I used to always think I had to be one Lisa, but it's loads of different Lisas that appear, dependent on the energy that she's in front of and the energy that's coming up in her. It's being honest. It's not trying to fix it into one thing, this fluidity. And then also who I truly am, what is that which knows Lisa, not the appearance of Lisa, that which it all comes from.
And so in most circumstances recently, I'm feeling that until the family situation, and then I'm trying to reconstrict and go into the peacock or the daughter that does this or the sister that does that.
And
that's what...
And you'll also notice, though, that you also are putting up the cages of other people because you have to in order for that to happen to you. So you suddenly then see them as something.
Totally.
Yeah.
Totally. Because the forgiveness I give to other people for, like you say, some person says this and another person says the exact same thing. This person gets all the latitude in the world to say it. But when the family member says it, it's like, oh my gosh, why did you say that? Right? And it's as much as I am put in the box, they are put in the box by me. Is there a breaking or a softening or a...
Yeah, no, that's happening. I mean, it's just the fact that you're willing to talk about it, you're exploring it, you're into non-duality, the deconstruction of you is happening. So the listening to non-duality and listening to that you are not that person is being experienced isn't you, so that the non-dual side, I would say. And then also this other part, which I suggest, is keep putting the attention back onto the lack and the fear and seeing how that produces these functionings, and it will soften because there will stop being and acting out of that. That energy will begin to loosen. It's loosened in all the other areas and it will loosen in the family, but they always say if you think you're enlightened, go and spend time with your family. My thing with my family always used to be, I have such a great relationship with my mum and dad now, but my thing with my family used to be that, you know, you have this idea of what peace is, and I just love my family's fire now. I'm fire. I have fire in me. Like it's, I used to think that peacefulness was a way of being, but peacefulness is not trying to be someone, and that doesn't look like anything. So when I'm with my family, like I just love, like they're so funny, like they're so funky and sparky and full of life. There's whereas before I used to think that peace was being like a Buddhist or something, and I used to think they needed to be peaceful or they needed to not say things. And it's like, and we have such a laugh about it because, like, my mum can be spiky or not spiky, like, she can have a jab. She'll be like, oh, here goes Lisa again. She's gonna smash everything. I'm known as the clumsy one. And, like, so this is my title. So if anything's broken, if anything's messy, it's always Lisa. So, and it's like, and now, whereas in the past I would try to block that energy, now I find it really funny. And then I'm like, hi-ya, here goes the daggers. And it's like a, it becomes like a dance. It's like a dance between us. Like, I'm not rejecting that fire. It's not like I have an idea anymore of what they need to be. They are as they are, and I dance with that energy. And when I'm with my parents, I'm so much more. So now I've got my spicy dog telling the other dog that he's got to go out. No, Khaleesi, you don't tell him that. It's not your job. Like, peace, we get these ideas of what we need it to look like. And it's,
Along or
yeah. And really, it is as it is in each moment, and it's always changing, and it's a response, it's a dance in the instant, and it's letting go of any ideas about what you or they need to be at all. No morality sticking to anything, no idea. But this has to, you have to keep coming back to that lack and that fear, because this is what blocks you and makes you close to them.
okay.
And then when you, and they will begin to change in certain ways when you stop blocking them, but then in another way, there might be a moving away from them. Like,
Okay.
there might also be a moving away and not dealing with that energy so much. I've got to admit, I really dislike these big family parties that my mom makes me go to. Oh, I'm like the single spinster. When are you going to get married? When are the kids coming? And I'm like, oh, what are you doing with your life?
Now that doesn't offend you or
No, and I do it for my mother. I wouldn't do it if it wasn't for my mum. I do it because my mum, I say to her, look, mum, I really don't like doing this. And then I say, do you want me to do it for you? And she says, yes, and don't say you don't like it one more time. And I'm like, okay.
But then that's okay because that's part of the dance as well.
Yeah, and I'm happy to do things for my mother. Like,
Okay.
I find my mother's energy very enjoyable. So I'm happy to do things for her, but I also limit it. I say, okay, I'll do this one, but I'm not doing the next one. So she just had her 40th, and I was like, okay, I'll do this one. The
Okay.
40th wedding anniversary of my dad. It was like,
Yeah, because I think, I mean, it's
pfft.
okay. I'll have to just explore. So in the presence, because today actually we had a family thing, and I noticed a couple times it was. I mean, yes, the chitter chatter or whatever, but then I also would notice that there was an okayness, which is the first time I felt that for a while. Like I didn't have an armor, and then all of a sudden I went, "Oh my gosh, I don't have my armor on!" And then I put it
Oh,
on.
yeah. Oh, nice. But it's nice that you tasted that.
Yeah, I did, but there is a little bit of fear there to not have it on.
For sure. I mean, I mean, I mean, you make it sound like it's not a big deal to not have the armor. It's huge. It's huge. We know most people normally just in with family have huge protection systems on. It's huge to stand there vulnerable and naked in front of people.
Yeah, even telling you that now, it's like, oh my God, I did, didn't I? But yeah, and I guess maybe and I think now I see the contrast because I feel like, I mean, with my immediate family here, I don't have it on. There's no rules. It's kind of very, everybody can be what and who and whatnot. But, and most of the time, I believe when I'm going out in the world, it's not on. But so the contrast of when it goes on and when it's off is really big.
It really doesn't feel, it doesn't feel nice.
No, it
I
doesn't.
notice. So
It
that's,
doesn't.
but it gives you compassion because that's what most of your family are in. They haven't even questioned it a little bit. So most of those people are in that, they're not even aware of it.
No.
That armored, dead state of really protecting
Yeah.
everything and pretending it's nice on the surface. Oh yes, this person's wonderful and this is
Yeah.
this and.
Yes, exactly. So, okay, all right, well, hopefully we won't have a get together for a while and not get This leads me to the other thing that I wanted to ask you or just make comment about was I listened to you Wednesday and it was kind of fun that you went on a rant about marriage and whatnot.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I knew I was going to, I actually surprisingly didn't get much feedback from that. Sometimes when I go on a rant about something, I get really shocked.
I think what I loved about that was, like you said, the authenticity, and I think that's what you're talking about even now, was, again, my old image of what enlightened or whatever would look like would never do something like that, would never say, and so I guess...
I don't remember exactly what I said, so so when you say like that, I can't really remember, but I get the picture, but
the
I can't really, I remember going off on something, but I can't really remember what I said.
It was very, it felt like a very strong opinion, and it felt like a very strong, and more than anything, it doesn't matter what you said, it was just that it felt like that. It felt like a strong opinion, a very, a solid stance.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I think that surprised me in the sense that I think I have an image of what enlightened looks like.
Yeah.
That won't be there.
Yeah.
And is, I guess that's a mistake. Do you know, do you understand my question? I'm not even sure what my question is, but I guess, do I still, I mean, will.
Oh yeah, to still be strong opinions. Like I'm really, I mean, I'm a real, if I were to be honest, I don't really understand the principle of communism, but if I were to speak about a society, I really disagree with the distribution of money. So I don't understand the principles of communism. I understand that it wouldn't work in our society, but I have very strong beliefs in this, and I really also disagree with the treatment of animals in our society as well. I'm not against eating animals, actually. I think that's really normal, but I'm against the treatment of animals, and I'm against the distribution of money in our society. And I think it's really stupid capitalism, like a really, and but that's just Lisa's opinion and it doesn't really matter. And I'm not really, I wouldn't ever, like would I go into an argument? I went to say I wouldn't ever argue about it, but it's like a fun, it's more like a fun thing. Like this week we, do you know what happened in Europe this week?
Yeah.
That we,
yes.
That we basically, it's like what happened in England is like you guys getting Donald Trump as your president. Basically, racism works. But that's a really strong opinion. I mean, that's a really controversial opinion in the UK to say that out loud. So that's a really controversial opinion, I would say. But I also find it really fun and exciting. Like afterwards, me and my friends are all texting each other like, what sort of society do we live in? How has this happened? But those friends, having said that, those friends are all married and I can't express my marriage views to them.
But the views, so the views will stay?
But they're not anything. I just find it fun. Like, I find it really, I love it because I'm a Gemini, a triple Gemini. So a lot of my energy is in philosophy, thinking, communication. I love it if somebody came to me with a really outrageous idea and explained it to me and we picked it apart for hours and hours. Like, so
that's a
great pleasure for me. So if somebody came to me and said that we actually humanity originated from an alien, which I think a lot of people theorize about, an alien genetic got put into us and they had all this information, I would love exploring that with them for hours and hours and hours and hours. Somebody was recently telling me about this new money form that's happening on the internet where it could replace money, and I was so interested. I found that fascinating. So I love all these things, and I love having heated arguments, like passionate arguments with people, but I also don't care.
Okay.
Like, I was also a bridesmaid for my best friend's wedding recently, even though in the middle of the ceremony I was like, but that's, and I wouldn't say it to her because I know that she takes marriage too personally. Like to her, I wouldn't say it to her because I know that was really special for her. And I know I'm saying on this, but I also know she wouldn't watch it. I would say it to her if she really, really asked me for my opinion. But for that instant, I know that that was a really important day for her and a really important thing to happen to her. And she really wanted that. And if she asked me my opinion, which she was very careful not to, because I suspect she knew what my opinion was, I would have told her, but I wouldn't have outly said it to her. So I don't,
So we will, I mean, so there's just that, so a
But
continuation
it
of.
doesn't offend me anyone's opposite view. Like
Okay.
her view about getting married doesn't offend me. Like it doesn't, it's not that it offends me or not offends me. It's like that's the spice of life. That's that bundle of energy. I personally don't agree with it. I personally I'm not into that. I'm a lefty to the extreme. But I find that funny as well. It's not like I'm right. It's just this bundle of energy. I grew up with a father who's a vegan and a businessman, and like I'm always gonna have these sorts of, I love deconstructing everything and I love being fair and looking at all the different ways to be fair. But that's this personality and this juice and this, and I find now that my opinions in a way are more so because I'm not afraid of expressing them, or I'm not afraid of them. But I really am not afraid of anyone disagreeing. In fact, if someone disagrees, it makes it more fun to discuss.
And then in the end, it's just that it's not personal.
And it's not real.
And it's not real.
Yeah. I mean,
So it's just words coming out.
yeah. And it's just a pass, it's just a fun. It's like playing table soccer. You know, it just means nothing. It means nothing really, ultimately, what society we live in or how it's organized. I have my opinion of what I think would be the best, fairest, loving way. But it doesn't mean it's the right way, and that will have problems too. The freedom is always this instant, and each character will have its flavor. And as you begin to accept yours more, you'll accept all other flavors. I remember when people used to have the opposite idea to me, I used to find it offensive. I was angry with them for having the opposite idea. Whereas now I'm dressed up in my bridesmaid uniform with like totally, like this is alien to me, and I'm like da 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 da. And I was like head bridesmaid. And I had to do the buying of the presents, and it was like, but I loved it. I loved that as well. I loved doing the whole thing. I loved also feeling sick in the speeches. Like, they're not really sick, like a child, like, bleh.
In that it's because I think probably again it's the misconception of that you lose all of that, lose when you say you lose your world, it's not necessarily that you lose your preferences or your.
No, not at all, not at all. This is the big mistake. What happens, I mean, Lisa drastically changed, but she still always had her same flavour. But what happens is that there is. Lisa used to be the experiencer of life. She used to feel like she was the experiencer. And now, what's talking to you, what's speaking to you, is total silence. And then there is a flavour of Lisa, although she's invisible most of the time. There's a flavour of Lisa that comes up, and actually, really, other people see Lisa more than this sees Lisa. This is more flavours, like sensations, feelings. The words come out, but I'm not even really listening to it. And it's just energies that pass through, and somebody says a idea, and I also have ideas about who I think's the best tennis player, or how to bring up a dog. I don't know much about kids, but dogs. What else do I? And you tend to have your own passions. Like I like exercise and bike riding and like all those sorts of things. I'm trying to think of things like intellectual things I like. I like politics. I like thinking about how to make this us live better together. I like thinking about psychology and the workings of the people, like of humans and animals, all those sorts of things. Environmental issues I like thinking about.
Yeah, I think there was the misconception that that would go away.
What goes away is any attachment that that's you, and it's you really don't need anyone to see you like that anymore.
Okay, so it can come and go and be
Yeah,
and do
before
and.
it used to be like I needed to be seen a certain way. Like I, that was me, and I needed people to see me like that. I don't even know what Lisa is. Like when you said that thing about marriage, I wasn't even really sure what you were talking about. And then it was like, oh, because sometimes I'm trying to follow what people say because my memory's so bad. And then I was like, oh yes, I vaguely remember. And then it sort of came back more and more. And
Wow.
then, but it
Okay.
also makes you free to speak like that, because I know that that's going to really offend a lot of my, I know that most probably most of the people that are listening are like, I'd say 70 or 80% of them are mostly married, and they had to be like, I'm not against people that are married, and I kind of find it funny that my mouth opened up and said it. Like,
Well, and I didn't get offended, and I am married, but
yeah.
no, because to me, what I found fascinating was the freedom of the rant. I
Yeah.
think the only part, I mean, listening to you, I thought it was funny and whatever, but I think the freedom of that rant
Yeah.
was what was I loved, and then also just that you still did,
Yeah.
because it broke two misconceptions for me.
Yeah.
That it wasn't, it really wasn't what you said. It was,
But because I'm doing it, it means that when you're in front of me, if you do it, then more than likely this energy won't be rejecting it, because it wasn't rejecting its own rant. So then, therefore, if you suddenly went on about how George, I mean, I would love it if actually if somebody came on and started saying, I'd find this really fascinating opinion. If someone came on and started saying how Donald Trump should be the next president, and I have met someone recently who said this, and that argument was fantastic. It was a really good argument, and it really made me ponder it for a while. Like, I went back and thought about it, that Donald Trump should be the next president. And their argument, I didn't fully understand it, but we just talked about it briefly. Their argument was because the richest 2% is on Hillary's side. And I was like, huh. So the people with the money are actually backing Hillary. Donald's kind of on his own. The only problem is he might nuke everyone. But he hasn't got the support of the richest people, which is a good thing, because we're always being dominated by the very rich companies. So Hillary's got their support. Donald's kind of by himself. So but this took ages for him to explain this to me, but I was like, woohoo, I love it that somebody's just challenged my idea of Donald Trump. So,
And it was a play that you guys did.
yeah. Well, it was just happening. It certainly was interesting.
Okay. Well, I think you've answered my questions. Thank
Yay!
you.
Oh,
And now,
lovely to speak with you again,
thank
and
you
to
very
see you this time.
much. Yes, okay.
Thanks.
Much love. Talk to you
Much
later.
love. Bye. You see, guys, now, sorry, I think, hey, I just have to stop record again and then I'll start. So, hi guys, so you know the difference, and I'm going to keep pointing this out again. Did you notice that Marianne was op asking for from a very honest place, energetically? Now, not what she was saying or the surface conversation. What you'll notice it as is, you won't be wanting to reject Marianne. I know that's an odd thing to say, but you'll feel sometimes when people call in, because they're not being genuine, so because they're trying to be something, then there's more of a rejection of them. Because they weren't, our energies really flowed and we really spoke. And she, we just, there was just a sync that got going together, which is really beautiful. I'm not saying that the ones where it doesn't happen is really beautiful, but I'm just trying to point it out. The last couple of sessions, I've been pointing out those energies. And it wasn't so much about what we said or about her opinion or my opinion or what was right or wrong or anything on that level. It was more that neither of us were trying to be things. So maybe there was a little bit, but the energy really began to flow together naturally. And you'll notice this in every day with other people, when you're putting up barriers, when they're putting up barriers, and when those barriers are beginning to fall down, and it just feels like love. And that's what it is love. And then eventually you get to a point where you just feel like every conversation is making love to them, even if they're pro Donald Trump and you're pro communism. Even if you have these two extremes. And also, I'm really not offended by people's opinions. You know, you have the freedom to have any opinion you like and want to be, because none of it is real or serious. So you're loved as you are. The most important part is not what you show and what people see of you, it's that genuinity. See, some people, like there was this other guy that I blocked on Facebook because, like, he was being very racist against us leaving the EU, and I just felt he came from such hatred. like in such denial. Yeah. Okay. Next question. I can see Elango calling. I will try and speak to you today, Elango. Wow, another name that is incredibly difficult for me. Yes, we can speak.
Hey, Lisa.
Hey.
Hello there. Ah, we finally met.
Hey.
Can you see me? Yeah, you can.
I can see you, but you know, I can't read your name and put it into sounds.
Mathilda.
Oh, Mathilda, okay. Yeah.
Oh, hello there.
Hey, that's so easy, and I couldn't transform that into a word. Mathilda. Oh, hey. And you're Dutch, I presume, just from your accent, I can tell.
Yeah.
I love that accent because I lived there for so long.
I met you somewhere in December in Delfrau, where you lived then.
In Gouda? You came to my house in Gouda?
Yeah.
Ah.
I think I have to quit Skype.
Quit Ustream.
Ustream. Okay. We have on Skype, eh?
Yeah, we're on Skype now, yeah. I can't hear you on Ustream, but you most probably can. So just quit Ustream or turn the volume off.
I think we did it. I think I did it. Yeah. Okay?
Okay. So you came to my house. I don't actually recognize your energy face to face, but I most probably recognize it if I met you in person. But sometimes on Skype it changes. Nice to see you again. And whereabouts in Holland are you?
Sorry, again?
Whereabouts in Holland are you?
In Zutphen.
No, I don't know where that is.
The east part. Holland, I was crying for the when you were speaking, and beat him in a dark place, actually.
Yeah.
Sometime right now. And the funny part is that when I listen to you, I think about, I get all stuff in my face here. Okay, it's blocked. Sometimes I think when I listen to you speaking to other people, like, oh, I'm not in enough pain, or I'm not enough trouble with things, and then the other part is, oh, I'm really in such pain and trouble, and I don't, it's difficult for me to formulate.
It's okay, take your time.
Yeah.
And I really appreciate you taking time. Like that's a really beautiful thing that you have the confidence to just take your time and just to let that happen. It can be so intense, the energetical energies that come up, and so confusing because the mind tries to make sense of it and it.
Yeah.
because I don't know where I am.
Yeah.
And to ask you, am I on the right track, is crap also. Like, I want your approval or something.
Yeah. But that's on the surface level, that thought.
Yeah.
Like, so the thought that you should ask me, and then you think, oh, that's crap too, that's on the top, believe it or not. Although it's really profound in a way, like the whole of non-duality is really profound, that's not actually dealing with what's happening underneath the actual energy. So if you feel open to it, I could explore the energy that's going on in the body in the moment. And I just get the sense,
yeah,
this might be totally wrong and I could be really off, but I get the sense that there is a lot of fear and hopelessness coming up.
Like hopelessness, yeah.
Like that you're stuck in some way. But this is really fantastic. If you can look at the whole of life as an exploration, this is a really amazing place to have got to. Because most humans walk around as if they're robots, just in their head. They don't even know they have body with feelings. So the fact that you feel it and that you're sensitive enough to feel it means that you're sensitive enough to break that as well. If you were just stuck in your head, you'd just carry on trying to consume as much pleasure as you can. So it's really great that that's happening, but the person on the surface level is like, get me out of it, what is wrong with me, why am I like this? But if you can see it as an exploration, so now the exploration, if you look at it like explorers, like I look at it as like little minions going down into this world of darkness. And this world of darkness isn't reality, but it hides there in all humans, and they cut off into just this. And they try to just keep themselves dead.
Yeah.
And they do terrible things to each other when they're like this, in this dead place, this dead zone. Okay, so if we just go into exploring it, and I tend to ask people to shut their eyes when they explore it, just because it becomes, the energy becomes more, I do it with them as well, it becomes more easier to recognize. So there's all these sensations happening currently, like all these different sensations, loads of different sensations. There's a sensation on the skin of the warmth of the room. There's a sensation of the bum and the back touching the seat. There's a sensation of the thinking, the feelings, the heart beating, the breathing. And then the sensation of this tight contraction that's happening in the body. And this is what I would call suffering. This tight energy that feels like it's separate from things.
Yeah.
And do you have a place in the body at the moment where that contraction's tightest?
Now everywhere, but normally spoken here in the, yeah.
In the where?
The hara in the...
On the stomach?
In the hara.
Oh, here, this one. I'm sorry, do you know, I've got such a terrible memory, I can't even remember all the names of the different chakra places, and I studied it for years, like, it's just terrible. Okay, so the upper stomach, I can't even remember it.
Like, playing, making harakiri.
Yeah. Okay, so the tightness is here. So the tightness, and is that tightness appearing now?
It's softening now.
It's amazing. Putting attention onto the discomfort is really amazing. Just resting attention there. But notice in this, you've got two people already existing as you. You've got this contracted energy, which is you, and then you've got this other person, which is resting the attention on the contracted energy. So you've already divided. You're a divided person. And then you've also got the divided outside world.
Yeah.
But there's two parts of you. There's the feeling that you have, and then there's a person that acknowledges it and rests its attention there. And resting your attention on the feeling is the most amazing thing to do, rather than trying to work it out as to why it's there, what it's from. You can loosely explore it and what it wants to say, but resting the attention on it is so profound. In a way, it's like all it wanted you to do is like, it's like, I'm here.
Yeah.
But this is the most fascinating part, is that one that rests its attention on that feeling. The most interesting part is that one is also known, is being experienced by something. So something else is experiencing that person that feels like it's separate and can move its attention. So that person is also experienced, that one that moved its attention. This is really profound. So you that feels like it's in control of moving the attention and thinking is also being experienced. So there is that contracted energy that feels like you, and there's the person that moves the attention which feels like you. And both of those are known. They're both being experienced, they're registered, therefore they're happening in the dream. Something registers them. And that's who you truly are. Is that register, which is that registerer, though, that one that knows, which isn't located. And the freedom is that movement from being that tight energy. And the reason it stays a tight energy is because it believes that its solution is finding answers in time and in the intellect. But actually, it's that which knows it all. And that knower is boundless. It's non-located, it's everywhere, and it's nowhere at the same time. That knower is the sound of my voice. That knower is the room. That knower is the feelings, is the thoughts, is everything.
Yeah, the point is, Lisa, that I think I want something from it. Like, if I'm maybe I make a mistake.
Sorry.
They're playing.
Yeah. So if I don't give him the toy, he won't shut up. He's like that sort of kid. He's like, I'm just gonna bark until I get it. Yeah.
That when I do this, that I should be feeling immediately a change in something.
Yeah.
The idea I have about it, and I have been experimenting with what you said. Just keep on putting the attention inside.
Yeah.
And I have to say, it might. It's not changing a fucking bit. and for getting me inside, but I saw that I was trying that I was hoping that it would change.
Uh-huh.
But it doesn't.
Well, I wouldn't.
That I would be able to see, but I can't see, of course, the one who is watching the other parts.
Yeah. Yeah. Now this is, but this is great. So you have the thoughts. So this isn't. Firstly, what I'll say about the memory is the memory is very subjective to what you actually feel now. So if you feel vulnerable and you're feeling tight now, your memory is only going to be able to remember that. So it's not a very good source to rely on memory. Memory is, whatever you feel now, the memory will pull up memories that coincide with that feeling. So memories is not so reliable because it isn't present. But what is present is that you can identify that there is a hope there, that you are going to look like something else, and that you're looking back through time and you're saying, okay, I haven't changed, I'm still like this, and I hope that there's going to be something different. And that we take as some reality, that this is actually talking about what's happening. And we're used to using these feelings and thoughts to victimize ourselves. Like that this feeling or thought has, like, we use it as a way to put ourselves down. We're victim to something. It hasn't changed, or whatever it's saying. But this thought is the surface level. And I know that you most probably, why should you believe me, or you want results, but you only ever have this moment, and trust this moment. So not rather than me, trust the moment. So what comes up is the thought that you would like something else in this, and you're hoping it will change. So that's the thought. Now that talks about time, and time is never present in the moment. So I let's say we just discard that thought because it's speaking about time, which isn't here. So that thought says it's true, that you haven't changed and you hope you will, but the next moment and the last moment aren't here, so we just go back to what we are here. So that very thought implies that you feel like there's something wrong with this moment.
Yeah.
So that implies that you feel that this isn't enough, and that's fair enough, that's how most humans are.
Yeah.
So you have the sensation in your torso somewhere that there is an issue, and that's fair enough. That sensation is more real than those thoughts, let's say, because that's actually appearing now. The thoughts are about past and future, and that's dodgy, but the sensation is there. So the tight sensation is there. So there has got to be a real exploration of that tight sensation, because that's what's currently arising. Not what the sensation says. So the sensation says you're not enough. The sensation says this isn't enough. I don't like this. Why aren't I changing? I want something else. These are all thoughts in time, and they can come up, but they can't actually talk about what's happening. But the more you delve into the sensation, the more that this moment will present itself. What's kept this moment veiled is the constant movement in time. So this sensation is always telling you to go to the next moment. So this is like an anarchy. This is like a rebelling. Okay, so the sensation keeps saying, let's go to the next moment. So if you go into the sensation, I know you say it's dissolving. Underneath it, there is this life force that's totally free. And it's not really underneath it. It's around it, and it is it. And it's there all the time. That sensation is peering in boundless space. Something knows that sensation, and something knows that person that doesn't like the sensation. And I can't talk this out with you. I can keep repeating it, but there's always got to be a going into that. You can't let these thoughts grab on, because they are not present, so they cannot have any truth in them. The sensation is seemingly present, but it's actually made up of false ideas. And then behind that, there is this huge space that's always free. But you always have to go backwards from the thoughts. So you don't follow the thoughts forward. You follow them backwards to the source of where they come from. And in that, there is this freedom. There is this complete deconstruction of everything. But this place you would never go to, because this place feels uncomfortable. Sorry, you're going
to
say something.
Yeah, here is it again. Because you say when you go to the feeling, then there is the, what was the name? Then there's the freedom. There is the, and if you say that, then I go in, and I for my feeling, I have to look for that freedom over there.
Yeah.
And actually, this is what happens with seeking. With all the seeking I am doing, and I take the heart for that to just go to the feeling. But if you say like there is something, then there's the freedom. That I go and look for the freedom.
Yep.
What's there?
No, yes, and that is an effect that happens, but always use it as something, go backwards on that thought.
Yeah.
It's looking, okay, so where's the freedom? But that's not it. That's like, okay. So then focus back to the feeling, and then it's like, okay, where is the freedom? And notice those thoughts are appearing in knowing. Something knows them as well. And I know it's going crazy looking for it, but let it do that. And then keep seeing that they're coming from lack. Don't be victim to this part of it. Like, what it's trying to do is it's trying to tell you that there's something deeply wrong with you and you'll never get there. And this is the whole problem of the seeking process. You are always going to fail. And in one way, you are going to fail because you do never get there. But the freedom is there. It's not a myth, this freedom I'm talking about. And it is your nature. It's everything's birthright.
I'm somewhere I know.
But the thing is your mind at the moment, today, and it's always changing, it keeps wanting to be victim to something. You are not victim. You are the most powerful creative source there is. Who's listening to me now is that powerful source, is the creator. Who looks at me, who hears me, who sees me, is the source. It isn't that person that's saying, I'm not enough, I'm victim too. It's so powerful. There is nothing that's victim here. To a practice, but every time those thoughts are going into time, that's an indication, that's a bell that it's not true, that there's an alarm, not a bell, it's not true. The underneath there is always, I am victim too, I am not loved, I am scared, this is going wrong for me.
Yeah.
It's a painful process though. It's the way of the warrior. But it's there in the sights, it's there in the sounds, it's there in everything that appears.
Just keep on crying all the time.
This is fantastic. I know it doesn't feel fantastic for you, and your mind's like, where is my freedom? Where is my freedom? But this is that dank energy that's gone on for thousands of years in humanity coming out. So this new generation, or this generation, the next couple of generations has to do this with humans kill themselves. Because we're being too greedy now. So you're crying for all your ancestors, for every story that ever happened. For all of that information of humanity. So there's a lot of tears in a way that's to come. It's so beautiful though, because when you're crying and when you're laughing and when you're dreaming as well, all these energies are changing and being let go of. The mind keeps saying, no, I'm a failure, because that's what we feel deep down, is that we're wrong, we've got it wrong, I'm victim too, I've done it wrong. It always feels that, fear and lack, and it keeps trying to go into the thoughts. No, there is something wrong, this is what I always do. It keeps trying to work it out, and this is free fall from anything you think you know. And you can always use it as an alarm, like the... As soon as it starts saying anything like that. The dogs are a little agitated tonight because I did talks at my house today, so they haven't had as much attention as they normally get. So I had talks this morning and then I went out for lunch with everyone. And so now they're like, hello, we're here.
Yeah.
And they want their dinner as well. I didn't feed them before the talk. So like... They're very well treated dogs. I always make it sound like, oh, I've been a monster, but it's just occasionally I don't get these things done. They're too spoilt.
Thank you so much.
Oh, with pleasure. With pleasure.
Couldn't pronounce my name.
Yeah. And you can watch this back on YouTube so you can hear things again, because sometimes you miss things when you're listening. Okay. Thank you, sweetie. Bye.
My internet is a bit slow.
Hey, Colin. Have we spoken before?
No.
No? I recognize your name, but...
Yeah, I had some discussions with Paul. Well, not discussions, but comments and so on. Maybe that's why.
Oh.
And also, I've chatted before. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I've put comments on, yeah. So cool. I just thought I'd call in just because, you know, I'd see if it was possible and then... see what happens.
Yeah.
Basically, I don't have a particular you know, topic or anything.
Well, we tend to stick to non-duality. No, I'm only joking.
Yeah.
We can talk about politics.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was thinking of Brexit a lot recently.
Oh, we're so stupid as English people. I can see that maybe if it screws up the top 2%, then that's a good thing, but...
That's what I was thinking, like, because what if EU is a globalist, you know?
What the EU did to Greece and Spain is really terrible, but then I kind of think if we pull out, then we're leaving Greece and Spain and we're, like, one of the richest countries. But at the same time...
So complicated. Things are moving very quickly nowadays.
Yeah.
You know, like, all the Prime Minister, you know, resigns.
Yeah.
And all these things are just rapidly happening. It's kind of exciting.
Yeah. But it's quite good that there's not been any fights or there's... I mean, England wasn't any big riots or anything because it's pretty 50-50, so the people on the street weren't fighting about it. Like, we've not been having mass outbreak of violence or anything because it's pretty racist what's going on the streets. Like, it's like I've heard lots of stories about people going to anyone that's not white and doesn't have an English accent, that they're to go home. Like, so it's really, and it's amazing that it's not gone into, at the moment, into lots of violence or anything, like that it's still managing to stay together. So I thought that we might see lots of fights and riots and violence, but we haven't.
I never thought of that. Yeah, I hope not.
Because you've got basically the split 50-50, and then we're all living amongst each other. And we pretty much know who's voted who. So the middle class people that are under 40 or 45 have mostly voted in. Working class have mostly voted out, and the older generation's out. So you can pretty much tell before who's voted in and who's voted out. But obviously it breaks. Like, there's always going to be some people that did and some people that didn't, either way. But that's what they think the statistics are of who's voted.
It's really fragmented, the UK, hasn't it? Yeah. You have Scotland potentially leaving, Northern Ireland.
Yeah.
Well, or, you know, the unification of Ireland, etc.
Yeah.
Well, if we're on different topics, as I meant, I said in my comment.
I didn't remember your comment actually.
Well, it was just about, like, I've come across this whole other body of knowledge from the light worker community.
Oh,
yeah. I don't know if you've come across that yourself.
Not really. I don't know much about it.
Okay, because it's like, it's pretty fascinating, but I'm just wondering how it jives with non-duality, because there are people, you know. Many, for example, ET experiencers, you can search ET experiencer on YouTube, and they have this common experience, common knowledge coming through.
Yeah.
And it's pretty fascinating, like, and just sort of broadens one's concept of what reality is and what's going on in some sense. I don't know if it's like completely crazy or what, sometimes it seems like that, but because there's this commonality, it's beginning to make me wonder, like, is it, how does it jive with, you know, other spirituality?
Well,
like
even if there are ETs, or there are, like, even if we come from aliens, or there are channeling of ETs, or there are different realities, the question always is who's experiencing it? Even if this was a dream where, or a reality where we're all aliens, or we're all ghosts, or we're all spirits, or we're all light children, who experiences all of that?
Yeah, I think non-duality is sort of the deepest knowledge.
Yeah.
It gets deeper than all that stuff, and you can just sort of frame that other stuff as phenomenon.
Yeah, but it's really amazing, and it's great to challenge the traditional concepts. To have a brain that can be that flexible and to think about all these different things is amazing. Most probably are aliens and different dimensions and all these types of things.
Well, you know, what I'm getting a sense of is that, you know, we all have... we're souls that have come from, potentially from other planets, other ET races, especially those who have incarnated here since the 1950s. You know, there's this whole scheme of ideas that comes along with ET experience or community, and one of them is that, you know, you have spirit guides, you have ET family that's looking over you. You have life review. You have like the Earth wants to go to the fifth dimension. There's like dimensionality. Like that this is actually a prison planet,
yeah,
etc., etc. It's pretty, but I guess you haven't really delved into that, but...
No. So I just have to let the dog in. It's just, I didn't get to all my routines with the dogs today, so they're requiring attention. But carry on. I'm listening.
Yeah, well, I guess, I imagine that Paul, I forget his last name.
Yeah.
He probably has come across this stuff, like he's more into conspiracy.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, that's why I was just curious how you, what you've experienced as someone who has attained some kind of awakening.
Yeah.
Like, you have awareness of other dimensions, for example. Like, apparently there are, you know, there's some people who are starting to remember their past lives and all this knowledge, and they're for example, activating the Earth's grid, and the whole scheme of this universe is becoming apparent to them, like the level, the dimensions, and it's not, the only reason I haven't thought that it's just bullshit is because there seems to be a common knowledge that I've been piecing together from disparate sources, you know?
Yeah, well, what was your question again? Have I become aware of it?
Have you, in your awakening, have you sort of become aware of other, for example, other intelligences, higher dimensional beings?
I don't understand what people mean by different dimensions. Like, I have my own interpretation of it. But you tell me what you would describe as another dimension.
Well, I mean, but what I'm getting, my understanding is there are, you know, dimensions that are overlaid into this three-dimensional world, okay? So you have just dimensions of this God's creation doesn't just include the third three dimensions.
So what would be a fourth dimension to you?
Well, you have different realms, in a sense. You have, like, the angelic realm. You have realms where beings just manifest their thoughts instantaneously, for example. You know, you have a heaven. Heaven is like a fourth dimensional realm, but they even have, I mean, it gets very specific.
Yeah.
And like strata of creation, where you get more and more refined, and it's just the process that the soul goes through as God experiences itself. Like the third dimension is the most dense, and it has the most duality, and the other dimensions have less and less duality. And you can hear, you can read, for example, Paramahansa Yogananda, some Indian gurus talk about other dimensions, like there's, you know, other realms, so to speak, where it's more ethereal, you know, and you have angelic realms, you have blah, blah, blah. You know, that's what I'm getting at. And I think, you know, physics can also, you know, they posit that there are other dimensions. Quantum physics, they say that, like, superstring theory posits that there are maybe 12 dimensions wrapped up, spatial dimensions wrapped up in our reality at a smaller scale. So it's not, it has some tie to physics.
And what benefit does it bring you being more dimensions?
No, it's crazy. It's just all this information that's flooded my consciousness about that I hadn't been privy to before. I've come from more like the Eastern philosophy, yoga, spirituality,
yeah.
And now I'm getting flooded with this information. I'm just wondering how to reconcile the two bodies of information. But for example, they would say that you have a higher dimensional self, you have a higher self, okay? You have a soul self, and it could be doing things on other dimensions without you being conscious of it particularly. You know, like, it's just a whole realm that people will awaken to as ET experiencers, and
the thing is what I see is that anything is possible in this moment. Anything is possible. Like, we don't know how life is going to manifest in this moment, and like realms in a way, or different realms. Okay, if we go into talking about that, what benefit does it bring you by imagining them? I think it could bring a benefit, as in it's great to break down any concepts you have. So if you have any stuck concepts, and these are really funky things to think about and really challenge everything we think we know, but what does it benefit you if there is lots of different realms?
It's like, oh, you should raise your vibration, basically, because you want to ascend with the planet.
But you see, I see everything really differently. Like, I see the want to raise your vibration is that you're saying to me that you're not enough as you are, and that you haven't discovered that your essence, your birthright, is boundless freedom and absolute love and everything you ever wanted.
Yeah, and I would agree with that.
But I also think it's okay to explore all these different realms and to explore all this different thinking, because it challenges any stuck ideas we have that this three-dimensional world is a reality. It isn't. This isn't a reality. This isn't a truth. And that any ideas stuck to that is untrue. But really, like, hiring your vibration or being in a better realm is basically that there hasn't been a discovery of that which experiences everything. And that which experiences everything's birthright is absolute love and freedom. And it never requires a different dimension. It never requires a different appearance, because it in itself is inherently free. But I'm not against the exploration of it, because it could, like, I mean, it's amazing. I love meeting people with loads of radically different ideas. It's such a beautiful thing to see a mind that doesn't stick to any possibility.
Yeah, I'm an Aquarius, so I have that inclination.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm into astrology.
Yeah. So I think it's a great thing, but I think that all of this is appearance stuff. And no matter what realm you're in, heaven, hell, non-dual realm, the freedom is what's happening. I'm sorry, your Skype keeps cutting out a little. Sorry, I keep overspeaking you.
Sorry, it's because I'm tethering with my phone, I think. It's a little bit... But I was just saying, like, yeah, it can get tiresome, all this phenomenal information, and non-duality is appealing in the sense it just gets down to the core of things.
Yeah, and then any appearance can appear, you know, who knows how this is going to be, and to, like, it could manifest past life, future lives, psychic abilities, non-psychic abilities, heavenly realms, non-heavenly realms. Like, it appears as it appears. Sorry?
That's why I was curious what your experience is as someone who has awakened, you know, to
whatever. Well, this is the love realm for me. Whatever realm that is, if that's a good or bad one, this is a love realm.
Okay. So, like the feeling of unity consciousness and divine love, sort of sense? Or?
It feels like everything is constantly making love to itself. But it's not really a feeling. It's an intimacy. It's like it's not like a feeling of, like, I as Lisa am making love to everything. It feels like an intimacy with all things, that there isn't a divide between who I think I am or my sense of self and anything that appears. So the sound of your voice is the recognition of myself. The sight of your face is me.
That's cool. Yeah, I've had glimpses of that, like, say, on the walking on the beach and feeling like I'm the wave that's just crashing. Mm.
That's your nature. That is your nature just revealing itself in that moment. That's the birthright of all things.
And I hesitate to try to think, I want to accelerate my consciousness in that direction, right? Because,
well, if you think
that's coming from duality.
That's coming from a sense of lack, so you want to be something else. Whenever you want to be something else, it always comes from a sense of not being enough. But that's okay, just an awareness of where that comes from. And it's okay if there's passion in all these different realms and all this stuff and this juicy drama, go for it, because that's where the passion is, that's where the juice is. But see that what the seeker is, what the separation is it's always trying to feed itself with the future and always trying to avoid what happened in the past. Or sometimes trying to get back to the past, depends, but it's always trying to avoid pain and get to pleasure. But if that stuff interests you, then that's great, because it will deconstruct so much of your thinking. Why so many people are stuck in such a tiny three-dimensional box of this is the way things are, this is reality. So being open, I love it. I love it that you're more open to light beings than just that this world and that people aren't light beings or something. Or that you're more open to ETs than just this. this world as in not just this as in just this in a positive way. I mean, just like that there's only this reality possible. Yeah, that's beautiful, that the idea that anything is possible.
Yeah, I'm inclined to believe a lot about me.
Yeah, it's exciting. It's exciting stuff. But your freedom is always your nature, which is present, no matter what realm you're in. Even if you're in the heaven realm, the presence is there, the knowing, the awakeness is there.
So I'm just before I end, I'm curious to know how you would read me, like how stuck in my mind am I?
Well, I'm only seeing your head.
Yeah. Right, what does that matter though?
But it's hard to read someone when they just see a head that's moving. You're like, because you're moving your phone, it's like a nodding dot. It's hard to see. Yeah.
Like my body language or whatever.
I don't know, just to get your energy.
I have been someone who has, you know, tended to restrict my energy to
the head area.
And I like that your advice to, you know, just seek, like you're giving, what's his name, Yolando or whatever his name is, to just go see what you're feeling.
Yeah.
And be present with it. I think that's a good portal, you know.
Yeah.
But
I think that you've got a fantastic mind, and I think that your mind will naturally deconstruct itself. I think your mind will always challenge itself, which is really, really beautiful, and that's a great thing to have. But I would just, like with Alango, make sure that you bring it into everything else that's happening, because you're not just here. You are that which knows everything.
Yeah. Like one thought I had experiences sometimes where what I would call hearing beyond the veil.
Yeah.
Like you just, but what that taught me was that whatever ignorance I supposedly experience right now is cool, because that's part of
the
veil.
Yeah.
Like I'm doing it perfectly. I'm being as ignorant as I'm supposed to be. You know?
It really is a falling back in love with itself. And Lisa's, I'm all stuck on Skype, I see. But Lisa's, it's all getting stuck on my computer a little. But Lisa is totally, Lisa can be totally ignorant to things as well. We're always learning and updating. Like ignorant, not as in ignorant as in like suffering and identified, but ignorant as in not knowing information, like not challenging with new information. Like all of us have a tendency to be stupid or ignorant to certain situations and subjects. And so it's a total, like I'm not in any way saying that Lisa is this perfect, all-knowing instrument. She is an instrument that's prey to destruction as well as growth. She's prey to great things as well as bad things. Like it's in all of us. But what I talk about is falling in love with that perfection and imperfection that will simultaneously be happening. Like the non-judgment of any of it. I screw up. I make mistakes. I do beautiful things. Like all of us do. That's part of being a part of this creation. It's and it's really, really seeing the perfection in it all.
Eckhart Tolle, he sort of distilled it into one word, which was non-resistance to what is.
Yeah, but what resists it is this illusion which claims the body-mind mechanism, which claims the traits, and claims a limitation to be you. But who you are is everything that appears, not a limitation.
That experience of ignorance, I'm talking about the deep ignorance of separation.
Oh yeah.
That is actually, well, what I had an experience of was like, that was the way it's supposed to be, because the soul or whatever, it's just experiencing that duality, that experience. So it's like, okay, on the one hand, we know everything, we are everything, right? And as the God self, but that ignorance experience maybe is valuable in itself. There's no repercussions for that, because what's truth is truth, right? So,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I know what you're saying.
Okay. So, but yeah, if you want to experience less suffering, it's good to get rid of that resistance to what it is.
But it's not your effort. It's naturally beginning to happen. Like you is something that appears in the dream. But yeah, it feels like you. But you is an appearance in it, and seeing that your nature is non-resistance. Your nature automatically is that, but the belief is that you're something in movement, whereas you are that which knows all movement and is all movement, the awareness.
But sometimes you can think of techniques like we always are feeding that separate sense of self, right? We're always feeding that, like, and so if you just stop the addiction to having a self and just, you can have this technique where you just say, okay, I'm not going to be feeding an idea of self, and then you can more easily fall into that, do you think?
Sure, if it's not going to get you to awakeness, awakeness already is, but it might cut that energy that's separating. There's all these beautiful things, and whatever attracts in the moment, if you feel attracted to that. My personal favorite is always going back to the sensations in the body rather than what you think you know. So rather than these techniques of more of a thought-based technique, I would, and challenging the thoughts, I would go to the feelings that underlie the thoughts. That would be my my cup of tea. As an English person, to go to the feelings, because the thoughts are always talking about time, and even though those contracted energies in a way are based in time, they in a way they're closer than the thoughts that move in time, because the thoughts are always talking about what has or hasn't been. They can never talk about what is. They're always talking about what has and hasn't been, whereas that energy is present. So if you're feeling lack of love or discomfort, it's kind of like an energetical sensation there that's happening in this.
Yes. Yeah.
That was a sweet face. I just show everyone else what you did.
Actually, you're stuck, so I can't see.
You can't see it. I just showed everyone. I can see you though.
Okay. Good. Yeah. I mean, I just had some success. You know, there's the concept in Indian spirituality of renunciation, right?
Yeah.
And if you renounce your idea of yourself, that I think that can be a powerful practice for some people, like myself.
I just feel to go back to point you to back to your feelings. Mm-hmm. I can feel now that the energy goes whoop. Like, you can't see me, but it goes up to the head. Like, I keep feeling like you're going up to the head, and it makes me feel dizzy. Like, sorry, it's just my response to it. But you've got to go back to the feelings. So right now, what are you feeling?
What am I feeling? Anxiety, actually.
Where are you feeling that?
Chest.
Chest. So when you feel that anxiety, more than likely your brain is going to try to find method. It's most probably going to try and find a way to deal with that, even though it's not conscious of it. But all that needs to happen is you need to just put attention to that anxiety and see that it's coming from fear. Oh, I can really feel it. So I have a little bit of a thing of this psychic stuff happens.
Yeah.
You see, and when you kept going to the head, it was beginning to make me feel dizzy because I knew it wasn't true, what you were saying. I know that sounds odd, but I knew there was something else going on. And then I feel that like something gets confused. So just put rest the attention there, and this is just an exploration of that. And that agitation or anxiety always comes from I'm scared of what things will do to me. I'm here and I'm scared of what's going to happen to me. And so you imagine things from the future hurting you, not consciously now, but energetically you have fear of life. You have fear, not all the time, it's just coming up now. You have fear of what these things will do to you as a permanent thing.
Yeah, and it could be subconscious too, right?
Yeah. So just like if you rest the energy there, you'll see thoughts or words or ideas that come up.
Yeah, so I guess if I get in touch with that, it's just, it feels like a child, you know,
yeah.
An inner child.
Doesn't know what to do.
An inner child of some sort.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would keep putting the attention back there. But I'm feeling like it's to end now. I've talked so much today. I did 3 hours live talk this morning, and then I've done another 2.5 hours So how long is that? 3 hours, 4, 5, 5.5 hours. Okay.
It's cool. Thanks for your time.
Oh, with pleasure, nice Colin. To nice to speak with you. Thank you.
Cheers.
Bye. Oh, Elango, he doesn't get to speak again. Okay, guys, so thank you very much. I shall see you on Wednesday, this Wednesday at 7 p.m. UK time. Okay, thank you. Bye.